President Marcos's economic team vowing to ramp up job creation following the lower employment figures in July. The National Economic and Development Authority says government will focus on the upskilling of workers and retooling programs to improve the labor market. It adds these are critical to helping Filipinos improve their employability. The country's trade deficit, which widened further in July. The total external trade in goods amounted to $16.4 billion in the said month. That's a 10.5% decline year on year. Exports amounted to $6.1 billion, posting an annual decrease of 1.2%. Imports also plunged 15% year on year, a steep 15.3% drop from July 2022.
Several deals also signed by the Philippines and Australia during the visit of Canberra's Prime Minister Anthony Albanese. These include a multi-million dollar funding for research to help the Philippines develop its soil strategy. Aside from agriculture, Albanese says other Philippine sectors with potential are education and green energy transition. Australia's leaders also reaffirmed his support for a rules-based economic cooperation in the region.
Australia is honoured to count Philippines as a close friend and from today, a strategic partner. Australia is working with our partners, including, of course, the Philippines, to shape a region where sovereignty is upheld and economic cooperation is underpinned by international rules-based trade. A region that is open, stable and prosperous with ASEAN at its centre.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. hails the World Bank for what he calls its desirable shift in programs designed to address post-pandemic challenges. Marcos met World Bank President A.J. Banga at the sidelines of the 43rd ASEAN Summit in Jakarta. Marcos noted how the Philippines has been benefiting from the organization's various grants. These include programs aimed at developing the agriculture and education sectors, helping the peace process in Mindanao, and its $600 million policy financing program. The World Bank, meanwhile, reiterated its ironclad commitment to the Philippines in helping the country address various economic challenges. The International Monetary Fund and the World Bank pledged better cooperation on key issues affecting the financial world. The two institutions, in a rare joint statement, vowed to work on climate change on a more structured and institutionalized footing, while also incorporating climate considerations into their work on debt sustainability for low-income countries. As for digital transition, the IMF and World Bank said they would help countries connect their citizens to online services and reduce barriers to digital inclusion. The statement was issued ahead of the G20 Leaders Summit happening in India this weekend. The Philippines and South Korea inked a free trade agreement during the regional gathering. The FTA, which was being negotiated long before the pandemic, is expected to cut tariffs for select products to zero to boost trade between the two countries.
The FTA will strengthen our bilateral trade and investment relations with the Republic of Korea, especially as it generates jobs and contributes to the Philippines' value proposition as an ideal regional hub for smart and sustainable investments. The signing of the FTA is a testament to the realization of the many opportunities for complementation and collaboration between the Philippines and South Korea, and an even greater milestone for our economic friendship.
Bilateral trade between the Philippines and South Korea amounted to $15.44 billion in 2022 alone. Among the Philippines' top exports to South Korea are integrated circuits, semiconductors, and bananas.
The unemployment rate climbs to 4.8% in July from the 4.5% in June. This translates to 2.27 million jobless Filipinos in the said month. Underemployment rate also on an upward trend. It came in at 15.9%, or at more than 7 million Filipinos who saw their jobs or wages as insufficient. For global recruitment consultancy firm Robert Walters, the latest figures show a decline in confidence in potential employees.
There is definitely a feeling of uncertainty and lower confidence levels worldwide, right? And the Philippines is as a market is, of course, not as isolated to that situation. Is reliant in many ways on the international markets. So we definitely felt a different sentiment in the first half of the year. Employers definitely having to justify hiring way more and being way more difficult. I'm personally very optimistic. I believe we are in a lucky market because we are receiving many interest from actually many companies based in the international markets. But of course, it's undeniable that you could feel the lower confidence levels in, candidates and clients.
For our numbers that matter this Friday, 14.24 trillion pesos. That's the Philippine government's total outstanding debt as of end July, and it is a new record high. Data from the Treasury Bureau show this is 0.7% higher than June's figures and represents a 10.5% year-on-year increase. The agency says the increase was primarily due to the net issuance of domestic securities. Of the total debt, 9.81 trillion pesos, or 69%, came from domestic sources, while 4.43 trillion pesos, or 31%, came from external sources. The Philippine Central Bank is in good financial shape to contribute dividends to the controversial Maharlika Investment Fund. That remark from BSP Governor Eli Remolona himself. Let's bring in our correspondent, Andrea Taguines, for the details. Andy?
And Denise, you're right, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas can afford to contribute dividends to the Maharlika Investment Fund. That's according to BSP Governor Eli Remolona during an online interview with a local broadsheet on Friday. When asked if he was worried that contributing massively to the fund could weaken the BSP, Remolona insisted that the central bank is in very good shape and that they are committed to support the fund in its first 2 years. In fact, he said they already released 31 billion pesos in initial contributions. Meanwhile, Remolona is also optimistic the Philippines can still hit the lower end of its 6-7% growth target for 2023, despite what he described as a surprisingly low second quarter GDP. He attributed this to government underspending. But if the Treasury Bureau and the Finance Department would succeed in addressing this problem, he believes a 6% growth is still feasible by year end. Remolona said they will be taking the GDP as well as the inflation numbers into consideration during the Monetary Board's next policy meeting on September 21. He said that if inflation continues to be an issue, then they could further raise interest rates from the current 6.25%. He added that, quote, if we think the tightening is very effective already, then we would not need to increase further, end quote. But aside from monetary measures, he urged the government to act as well, such as by importing certain commodities in the right amount to mitigate any more supply-side shocks. Denise?
Thanks, Andy.